Welcome to Monday Night Bible Study here at Lakewood. We are so glad you joined us tonight. Thanks for making God's Word a priority in your life. We're going to continue our study that we entitled The Unstoppable Church, a study of the church that Jesus established 2,000 years ago. Tonight I want to talk to you about the last words that Jesus had to say to the church. These words are recorded in the first three chapters of the book of Revelation. We're going to read a lot of scripture tonight, all of chapters 2 and 3. Remember that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. I believe as we read these passages, they will come alive to us, because God's Word is alive and powerful. I believe that God will speak to us, and His Word will encourage us and feed us and nourish us to grow spiritually, that it will challenge and correct and instruct us so that we can grow in righteousness, so that we can be more like Jesus, and so that we can be equipped to do all that He's called us to do. If you agree with that, would you say amen? Amen. Well, let me pray for us as we get started. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to gather as your people. Thank you, Father, for the gift of life. Thank you for a new day that brought your faithfulness in our lives. And Lord, we just say that you're so, so good to us, and we love you, and we embrace the love that you have for us. Thank you for the opportunity to gather as your people and open your word. Lord, as the people on the road to Emmaus, when you open the scriptures to them, may our hearts burn inside of us, Father, as your word is revealed to us. We pray that the eyes of our spirit would be opened and illuminated to your word as we read it and as we study it. Father, we pray that not only would we be hearers of the word, but we would be doers of the word. Thank you for every person that's listening. Lord, I just pray for every need that they have. Thank you that you're Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who can meet our needs. I pray you would meet their needs in abundance, Father. We thank you for it. Thank you for this time in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know if about you, but reading and studying the book of Revelation can be intimidating. When you read about a dragon and beast and the tribulation and the number 666, it can be confusing and difficult to understand. But in the first three chapters of Revelation, Jesus addresses seven churches, and his words are anything but confusing and difficult to understand. They are direct and clear and easy to understand. By way of background, the author of this book is the Apostle John, one of Jesus' disciples, the brother of James, the same James who was martyred by Herod in Acts 12. Scholars think that John was an old man when he wrote this book, maybe even 90 years old. He had been exiled to the island of Patmos, an island where criminals were taken, and he was exiled for his preaching of the gospel. He writes this book about 60 years after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. This is important because the churches he addresses aren't new churches. They'd been established for many years. For example, the church in Ephesus was probably 35 or 40 years old at the time John writes this book. Most of these churches were established in large cosmopolitan cities. Ephesus was the Roman capital of Asia, and had a population of 250,000 people. It was a crossroad of commerce and industry. Smyrna was known for its medical school. The whole area of Asia Minor was known as a pagan area. It was known for its idol worship and for its sexual immorality. The Temple of Diana was in Ephesus, and this is where lady priests would have sexual relationships with those who came to worship. And at the time that John writes this book, these churches had faced terrible persecution at the hands of the Roman Emperor Nero. Many Christians were martyred. Others had economic sanctions levied against them. They couldn't buy or sell things. As a result, some were facing extreme poverty. It was against this backdrop that the gospel of Jesus had been preached in this area. People were saved, came out of those pagan lifestyles, and became followers of Jesus. And these churches that we're going to talk about tonight were established. While studying this passage, it's important to know that it's Jesus who's talking. Notice that these words are in red letters in your Bible, denoting that they're Jesus' words. Let's look at the description of Jesus described in Revelation 1, 12 to 16. This is John talking. He says, "I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands." Remember that. "And among the lampstands, among them, was someone like the Son of Man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in the furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. Look at John's response to this vision of Jesus and Jesus' words in the next verse. When I saw him, John said, I fell at his feet as though dead. And then he, Jesus, placed his right hand on me and said, Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead and now look, I'm alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write therefore what you've seen, what is now and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars. Now Jesus is going to explain what he was talking about. The mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels or the messengers of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches themselves. Notice, the golden lampstand represents the churches. Lampstands are placed in areas of darkness. In the same way, the church should shine bright in the middle of the dark world in which we live. Notice it also says that the lampstands are golden. Gold is precious, signifying that individual churches are precious to Jesus. Also notice that the passage says that Jesus is walking among the golden lampstands. He knows what's going on in the churches. He's the one who started the church. He's the one that's watching over the church, and he's the one that's going to take care of the church. And that's exactly what he's doing when he addresses these churches in Revelation 2 and 3. And then for the next two chapters, Jesus addresses these seven churches, and he has a pattern of how he addresses them. First, he praises them for what they're doing right. He commends them. He lets them know what they're doing that pleases him. He does this for all but two of the churches, Sardis and Laodicea. So first he starts with commendation. And then second, he tells the churches what they're doing that displeases him. He gives them words of rebuke and correction and discipline. He does this for five churches. For two churches, Smyrna and Philadelphia, he had no words of correction. But note Revelation 3:19 gives us the reason Jesus corrects these churches. He says, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. So Jesus corrects and rebukes because he loves us, because he loves the church. So first he commends, and then he corrects, and then third, he gives them instructions in what he wants them to do to change. First commendation, then correction, then instruction. What I want you to see from these passages tonight is this, and it's very important. The next few sentences, really the whole message tonight hinges on these few sentences. What pleased Jesus in these churches 2,000 years ago is what still pleases him today. And what displeased him in these early churches still displeases him today. So as the church, it's so important that we learn from his words. As Jesus ends the words to each church, he ends with these words. He says, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He says this seven times. Let's pray tonight that we have spiritual ears that are open and receptive and ready to hear what the Holy Spirit might have to tell us tonight. First thing we want to do is read Revelation 2, 1 through 7. So read along with me. To the angel at the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. Notice Jesus identifies himself. He goes on to say, I know your deeds. He says this many times. I know your deeds, your hard work and your perseverance. I know you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you've tested those who claim to be apostles but are not and found them to be false. You have persevered and endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. What great commendations he gives the people there at the church of Ephesus. They're doing so many things right. But then he has something that he wants to correct. He goes on in verse 4 and he says, yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you've fallen. Repent and do the things that you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place. And then verse 7, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Now, let me draw your attention to chapter 2, verse 4, the words of correction that Jesus had for the church of Ephesus. He said, "Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first." The Amplified Bible says, "You've lost the depth of love that you had for me at first." The Message says, "You've walked away from your first love." And I love the Passion Translation. It says, "You've abandoned the passionate love for you that you had for me at the beginning." See, friends, somehow along the way in their Christian walk, despite all their activity for Jesus, these Ephesian Christians had lost that intimate, life-sustaining, relational experience with Jesus. They had it at first, maybe when they first got saved, maybe for a while afterward. But somewhere and somehow along the way, something had changed. Something was neglected. Now something was lost. You see, Christianity is a relationship with God, a relationship with Jesus. It's really like a marriage. We are His bride. He's the groom. And just like in any marriage relationship, our relationship with Jesus should be alive and dynamic, never static. Once a relationship becomes static, it comes to a standstill and begins to die. Just like a marriage, we have to be devoted to our partner. They have to have high priority in our life. And just like a marriage, our relationships are nourished and nurtured with quality time and communication and intimacy. I would imagine these Christians in Ephesus didn't forsake or abandon their relationship with Jesus all at once in an instant. It was probably a gradual process, little by little, taking place almost imperceptibly, almost unnoticed. Most of the time, relationships have a tendency to drift apart. I call this a creeping separateness. If you neglect a relationship, if you don't nurture a relationship, over time the separation becomes more and more obvious. And before you know it, you've grown apart and lost that sense of intimacy that you used to have. I would imagine that's what happened to these believers in Ephesus, working hard for Jesus. But you know what? They had lost that first love. We used to have some wind chimes near an arbor covered with honeysuckle vine. The vine would creep over onto the wind chimes. At first, it was beautiful to see the vines little by little twisting their way toward the wind chime. But with time, if we neglected the vine, if we didn't trim the vine, the music from the wind chime slowly came to an end. We couldn't hear the music anymore. Often that's the way it is in our relationship with Jesus. If He isn't a priority, if we neglect Him, if we don't pay attention to that relationship and nourish it, we can lose our closeness and intimacy. We can be in danger of losing our first love like these Ephesian Christians. Let's talk about some of the reasons that we lose our first love. I thought of four things. There are probably more, but the first is this. We equate Christian service with love and devotion to Jesus. Somehow the spiritual activity that we do for Jesus takes higher priority than our relationship with Jesus. Remember Mary and Martha? Martha was in a frenzy of activity, trying to serve Jesus and His disciples. Mary, on the other hand, sat at Jesus' feet, listening to Him. Martha came to Jesus in a tiff. "Don't you care that she's left me to do all the work by myself?" she said. Listen to Jesus' words. "Martha, Martha, you're worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen which is better, what is better. See, in all the things that we do for Jesus, let's not neglect the one thing that's most important, our relationship with Jesus. Another reason we tend to lose our first love is that our Christian lifestyle has become a habit rather than a love relationship. Listen to this next thought. It is possible to live the Christian lifestyle without being in a love relationship with Jesus. God becomes a habit we do instead of a person that we love. Another reason we can lose our first love is that the busyness of our life crowds out our quality time for a love relationship with Jesus. Remember the parable of the sower? The seed that fell among the thorns fell in good soil, but there were thorns in the soil. Jesus said it stands for those who hear the word, but as they go on their way, they're choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures, and they do not mature. See, friends, we can't let things choke out our relationship with Jesus. That's why He encourages us in Matthew 6:33, seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. In other words, seek Him first before even your service to Him. Another reason that we lose our first love, or we can lose our first love, is this. We allow ourselves to get too close to the world. You know, there's a very sobering scripture found in Matthew 24:12. Listen to this. Jesus said this, because of the increase of wickedness in the last days, Jesus said, the love of most will grow cold. See, friends, when we try to compromise and live like the world and not separate from us, from it, Jesus says that our love is in danger of growing cold. And then Jesus' instruction to the church in Ephesus is this, consider how far you've fallen, take inventory, look where you're at, and then repent. You know, admit you're wrong and change directions and do the things you did at first. So that's the correction for the book of believers at Ephesus. But let's look back at chapter 2, verse 8, and then we're going to read all of chapter 2 and all of chapter 3, and then we're going to summarize some of the things that we've learned there. Let's start on chapter 2, verse 8. To the angel of the church of Smyrna write, these are the words of Him who is first and last, who died and came to life again. Notice Jesus is identifying Himself. Verse 9, I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know about the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. So I want you to notice He's bragging on them. And then I want you to notice for this particular church in Smyrna, there are no words of correction. He goes on with instructions. Verse 10, do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful, he gives them instructions, even to the point of death, and I will give you life as your victor's crown. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who is victorious will not be hurt at all by the second death. Now we go on to the church at Pergamum. Verse 12, to the angel of the church of Pergamum write, these are the words of Him who has a sharp double-edged sword. Jesus identifies Himself. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you've remained true to My name. He's bragging on them. You did not renounce your faith in Me, not even in the days of Antipas, My faithful witness who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. Nevertheless, here's his correction. I have a few things against you. There are some of you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and they committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent, instruction now, repent therefore, otherwise I will soon come to you and fight against them with the sword of My mouth. Verse 17, whoever has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Verse 18, to the angel of the church of Thyatira write, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. Jesus identifying Himself. I know your deeds. Jesus knows what we do. He knows how we work for Him. I know your deeds, your love and your faith, your service and your perseverance, and that you're doing now more than you did at first. Commendation. Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads My servants into sexual immorality. I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I'll cast her on a bed of suffering, and I'll make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely until they repent of their ways. That's His instruction, repent. Verse 29, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the angel at the church of Sardis, in Revelation 3:1, these are the words of Him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Again, Jesus identifying Himself. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Now notice that He has no commendation to the church at Sardis. No words of praise, no words of affirmation commendation. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Instruction, wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. I have found your deeds unfinished in My sight. Remember, therefore, what you've received and heard. Hold fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Verse 6, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write these words. These are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. Jesus identifying himself. He goes on to say in verse 8, I know your deeds. Again, he knows what we do. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. Listen to this next verse. I know you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and not denied my name. I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you, since you have kept my command to endure patiently. I will keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the world, of the earth. Notice, no correction to the church at Philadelphia. And then in verse 13, whoever has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And then finally, verse 14, to the angel of the church at Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. Jesus identifying himself, and then notice there are no words of commendation. He goes on immediately to say, I know your deeds, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish you were one or the other, so because you're lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I've acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize you're wretched and pitiful and poor and blind and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich. White clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so that you can see me, so that you can see. Verse 19, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. And then verse 20, one that's very familiar to us. Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him, with that person, and they with me. To the one who is victorious, I'll give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. And finally, he ends it with this, whoever has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. May God bless the reading of his word. First, I've just kind of compiled all of the things that please Jesus and the things that don't displease Jesus into a list. And we're going to talk about this whole passage like that. Let's first look at Jesus' words of commendation. What pleases him? Because remember, what pleased him 2,000 years ago when John wrote this and Jesus said these words still pleases him today. One of the things that pleases Jesus is when we work hard for him. You know what? He said five times to five different churches, I know your deeds. I know what you're doing. I'm watching what your activity for me. We aren't working to try to earn our salvation, but we are working for Jesus because we love him and we want to please him. We come to Jesus without works, but then we go to work for Jesus. My dad used to say that. Let me say it again. We come to Jesus without works, but then we go to work for Jesus. Ephesians 2:10 says, we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he prepared in advance for each of us to do. Think about that, friends. There are good works for you to do and good works for me to do. We have to be about God's business, God's work. Jesus is also pleased when we don't tolerate evil. He said we don't tolerate wicked people in this passage. That means that we don't love people and witness to them. Let me say that again. It doesn't mean that we don't love people and witness to them and let our light shine around them, but we don't let them rub off on us. Very important. We can live in a sea of wickedness and evil, but we don't have to have that get inside of us. We don't have to have that be our behavior. Listen to Psalm 1:1. Blessed are those who do not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the company of mockers. Again, it doesn't mean that we can't befriend people that are living that lifestyle, but we can't let them influence us. 1 Corinthians 15:33 said, don't be misled. Bad company corrects good character. So important that we protect ourselves from evil. Jesus is also pleased when we test those who claim to be apostles but are not. In other words, we don't let people lead us astray, lead us away from the truth that is found in the Bible. And friends, people will try to do that. Come join our group. Come join this particular way of thinking. But you know what? You have to measure things against the Word of God and what the Spirit of God is saying on the inside. So make sure you test situations to make sure that people are not leading you astray. Jesus is pleased when we persevere and endure hardship and not grow weary. That's in 2:3. He's pleased when we endure afflictions and trouble and poverty with a good attitude. That's in 2:9. He's pleased when we keep going when we have little strength. That's in 3:8. Friends, you may be there tonight. You may be going through a very difficult time. You may be experiencing extreme hardship right now. You may feel like you have very little strength. I want you to know, just you holding on and keeping a good attitude and staying in faith and having gratitude come out of your mouth is pleasing to the heart of Jesus, just like it was when he said this to these churches 2,000 years ago. Paul tells young Timothy, endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. You know, we're in the army of God and it's not easy. Jesus said, in this world you'll have trouble, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. So listen to what Peter said. Listen to Peter's encouragement. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief and all kind of trials. These trials have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by the fire, may be proven genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. You see, friends, holding on to our faith and proving our faith in difficult times is invaluable to Jesus. And then James 1 says this, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kind, because you know the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. I don't know about you, but I want to be mature and complete, not lacking anything. But that means we have to go through some hard times and hold on to our faith and prove that our faith is genuine. Jesus is also pleased when we remain true to his name. When we don't renounce our faith, it's so easy to want to give up. When we don't give up, when we don't let Satan steal our faith. Remember the parable of the sower? When the seed that fell on the hard ground couldn't penetrate and couldn't develop roots. And the Bible says, Jesus interpreted this, said that's Satan that comes and steals the word from our hearts. So important we not let Satan do that. So important that we not lose our faith. Jesus is also pleased when we love well. That's in chapter 2, verse 19. You know, friends, we need to love God well, but we need to love each other well. We need to be growing in our love walk. In that great love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, the Bible tells us love never fails. You know what? God never fails us, but God is love, and love never fails. It goes on to say, now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Jesus is also pleased when we do more and more for him. It's in chapter 2, verse 19. In other words, we're not stagnant. I'm doing more than I did last year or 2 years ago. I'm more active for God and doing things for God. I love that scripture in 2 Corinthians 15:58. Be steadfast, immovable, ever abounding in the work of the Lord. To me, that means I'm doing more and more and more for Jesus. Jesus is pleased when we endure slander and persecution in a godly way. Friends, that's going to come to us. People are going to say things about us. We're going to be persecuted for our lifestyle, how we're living, and how different we're living from the world. But Paul tells Timothy, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So important that we realize that in order to, when we follow Jesus, people are going to say things about us, that slander. People are going to persecute us for how we believe. But it's so important that we realize that we have to endure that in a godly way. In other words, not lash out. Let God be our vindicator. You know what? Endure it and let God see us through it. Now I want to shift gears just a little bit and let's look at Jesus' words, not of commendation, but his words of correction. What displeases him? Because what displeased him when he wrote this 2,000 years ago still displeases him today. Jesus is displeased when we forsake the love we had at first. We've already talked about that. What did he say to do if that's the case? Repent and do the things you did at first. Jesus, friends, you can't escape this because it's twice in this passage. Jesus is displeased when we're involved in sexual immorality. That's in chapter 2, verse 14 and chapter 2, verse 20. Paul warns us in Ephesians, but among you, there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality. So important that we live blameless and pure lives in the sexual area of our lives. Jesus encourages us, if we're caught in that particular situation now, it's very simple. Jesus said, repent. I already said this once. Repent means admit you're wrong. Admit you're not living right and change direction. Go a different direction. Jesus is displeased when we're not growing in our spiritual walk. He said in chapter 3, verse 1, to one church, he said, you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. See, it's so easy to live our Christian life and make it a habit and not grow spiritually. Friends, we need to be growing each and every day. I thought when I was reading this passage, I thought of a passage, and it's not in the notes. It won't be on the notes, but it's in Hebrews, the 5th chapter, and into the first part of the 6th chapter. But this just emphasizes that we need to be growing in our relationship with God. This is the writer of Hebrews talking. He said, we have much to say about this, but it's hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand. In fact, though, this time you ought to be teachers. You need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's Word over and over again. You need milk, not solid food. See, there's a time where we need milk as a baby Christian, but we ought to grow up. And you know what? Then we don't need milk anymore. He goes on to say, anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching of righteousness. But solid food is for the mature who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. And then last, therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken toward maturity. See, friends, when we're growing in the things of God, nobody's going to say that we look like we're alive, but we're really dead, because we'll be alive and vibrant and growing in the things of God. And then Jesus is displeased when we lose our spiritual passion. And this is so easy to do. When we're neither hot nor cold, he said to the church of Laodicea, because you're lukewarm, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. Romans 12:11 says this, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Passion Translation says, be enthusiastic to serve the Lord, keeping your passion toward Him boiling hot. Radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit and let Him fill you with excitement as you serve Him. Friends, let's not lose our spiritual passion. And then lastly, Jesus is displeased when we think we are rich, when we're self-confident in what we have, but we're not generous toward God and others. He said in 3:17, chapter 3, verse 17, you say I'm rich, I've acquired wealth and do not need a thing. I don't need God. But you don't realize in reality, despite your wealth, you're wretched and pitiful and poor and blind and naked. See, friends, there's a danger when we are self-sufficient and have an attitude that we don't need God. And Jesus' words to that church in that particular situation, he says this, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich. Buy from me white clothes to wear so that you can cover your shameful nakedness. And buy from me salve to put on your eyes so that you can see. See, friends, our sustenance and our everything that we have comes from God. The day that we think that we've made it on our own and we don't need God, we're in a very difficult situation. That's why he's turning those Christians there back to him, say, buy from me or get from me what you need to live life. Don't live life on your own, feeling that you're self-sustaining yourself, because you're not. The only way we can live our Christian life is to have God sustaining us. Well, what's my encouragement to you tonight? Very simple. Let's work hard for Jesus. He's looking at what we're doing for him. Let's not forsake our first love. Spend time with him, abide in him, listen to his voice, talk to him. That's called prayer. Nurture your relationship, our relationship with him. Let's endure hardship and trouble and difficulty and persecution and slander with a godly attitude. Let's just keep going with an attitude of faith and with joy and with gratitude despite what we're going through. Let's not be lukewarm, but instead let's keep our spiritual passion and zeal. At all costs, let's avoid sexual immorality. And as Jesus said in this passage, whoever has ears to hear, let them hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. I believe that we've heard tonight, and I believe that we will not just be hearers of the word, we'll be doers of God's word as well. If you receive it, will you say amen? Amen. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to open your word. Thank you for the words that we've heard, words of encouragement, commendation, praise, words of correction, rebuke, instruction. Lord, we take them all and we say, speak to our hearts. And Lord, help us not to just be hearers, but if you've prompted us to do something, I pray, Father, for all of us that we would be doers of your word. Bring us back again Wednesday night or Sunday night, Father, as we seek you in the midweek Bible study or worship with you on the weekend. We thank you for each and every person listening. Bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, help them, comfort them. Whatever they need, heal them. Whatever they need, Father, be that for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. God bless.